Another gene is GAG, which is coding for the capsid protein, okay? The inner protein of the virus, and then there is an additional gene named POL for polymerase, because it codes for an enzyme, a polymerase enzyme that is now RNA-dependent DNA polymerase, because it transcribes RNA into DNA, and therefore got the name of reverse transcription. Usually DNA is transcribed into RNA, but it does a reverse function. It takes the viral RNA and translates it into DNA. So this is the life cycle of the virus. When it penetrates a target cell, it is de-encapsulated, its RNA material is now in the cytoplasm, and it carries the enzyme which will enable reverse transcription of the viral RNA into DNA, then this DNA will enter the nucleus, will integrate with the DNA of the host cells, and will become an integral part of the chromosome. So now when this DNA, okay, is multiplied in the cell, and using and is translated into proteins using the ribosomal machinery of the cell, this parasite virus will be also translated, giving rise to all the important proteins I told you about, to make a new virus particles with reverse transcripted into it. Okay? Most of these viruses are not harmful. Okay, we carry lots and lots of this kind of virus. Nothing happens. So why Rous sarcoma virus, the mouse mammary tumor virus, the murine leukemia virus, are causing cancer? That was a mystery for many years. And these two gentlemen, Michael Bishop and Howard Baumes, decided to study that question using Rous sarcoma virus. And you see here the simple structure of Rous sarcoma virus. And when they compare the sequence of Rous sarcoma virus to other retroviruses with the three genes, they found that Rous sarcoma virus contained one additional gene. You know what's the name of this gene? Haven't heard it before. Okay. The name of this gene is SARC, standing for sarcoma. Why? Because this gene, or the product, the protein product of this gene, is responsible, is the culprit for inducing sarcoma. If you isolate this gene and you inject it into cells, you get sarcoma. So these two gentlemen discovered for the first time a viral oncogene, gene that is causing cancer. And that's the origin of the term. Well, this is a very nice study, but still does not deserve the Nobel Prize. So they went on and did some more experiments. So let me just show you a scheme, because I see that you are not wearing the thing, how it works. So now you have a Rous sarcoma virus that carries the SARC gene, in addition to the three essential genes for the life cycle of the virus. Now the RNA is penetrating the cytoplasm with reverse transcriptase. It is made into DNA, including SARC. So now SARC is becoming SARC. The viral oncogene is becoming an integral part of the host cell. And when the new viruses are made, SARC protein is also transcribed and translated by the ribosomes. And this protein is causing sarcoma. This is an oncoprotein which is responsible for the disease. Okay, so now that we're using the genomic sequence of SARC as a probe to find more retroviruses in the genome of the chicken. So they took chicken cells. They made a probe from that sequence, and they were looking for, you know what a probe is? You can use it to find identical sequences in unknown samples, just like a blind man is using a white stick, you know, making his way through. That's how the probe looks like. And what do you think? They found quite a few new retroviruses in the genome of chicken cells, but, and they published it, but this publication was for work, and that was not that important. The great surprise came when they found that this particular probe is also detecting a sequence on chromosome number 7 of the chicken. It was not a retrovirus. It was SALK, which was detected by the viral oncogene SALK, the same sequence, even though it was divided into exons. So this was really a big surprise, because it indicated that oncogenes are not essentially viral. We have cellular oncogenes. The chicken has a cellular oncogene sac. And when they started to look at other species as well, they found that sac is abundant in Drosophila, in C. elegans, even in a woman, in frogs, obviously mammalian, mice, monkeys, and men. All of them carry sac. So this was such a big discovery that these two gentlemen were invited to Stockholm to receive the Nobel Prize in 1989. And it was a turning point for the entire field, because now we understand that the seeds of death, oncogenes that are causing cancer, are an integral part of every mammalian cell. Every human will carry oncogenes in its own genome. And the thinking today is that the virus, the retrovirus, hijacked SALK from a cellular chromosome upon an early infection, and now it carries SALK as an integral part of the virus, so the origin of the viral oncogene is actually a cellular oncogene. And this study evolved to an even bigger picture, demonstrating that SALK is only one member of a large family of cellular oncogenes. Some of them are receptors, growth receptors on the membrane, which respond to growth factors. Some of them are intracellular cytoplasmic mediators of growth stimulatory signals emerging from this receptor. Some are nuclear factors, such as transcription factors, all pretty normal products of our body, which can cause cancer. So why are they there? Apparently, all of these have important functions in embryogenesis, in development, in the immune system, in the nervous system, when cells of each this system receive outside signals. But what happens in the case of SALK, just as an example? SALK is an intracellular mediator of tyrosine kinase receptors that are expressed on the membrane, which respond to growth factors that are the ligands. So if there is no ligand, nothing happens. SALK is inactive. If a ligand binds to the receptor, SALK is active. When there is no ligand anymore, SALK again becomes inactive. So it goes up and down, obeys the rule of a normal cell. But the viral SALK is continuously active, no matter if the cell receives outside signals or not, if there are ligands or not. So if this protein is continuously active, it will induce cancer, because these cells will not cease to respond to a presumably outside signal. And there are other ways that oncogenes can be activated. If you look at the viruses that I mentioned, the leukemia virus, the mammary tumor virus, they do not carry a viral oncogene. But because they integrate into the DNA in a random way, then occasionally the mammary tumor virus will integrate upstream to an oncogene, for instance, SAR. And by that virtue, the cellular oncogene will be activated and you get cancer. Another way to activate a cellular oncogene is by chromosomal accidents. You know that when cells divide, there are occasional chromosomal breaks, and two chromosomes can join together. Normally, nothing harmful happens. This cell will die and will be replaced by other cells. But by rare occasions, which are truly accidental, okay, two chromosomes will be joined together or will be translocated together at a break point, which is at a vicinity very close to an oncogene. And this oncogene will be activated. So for instance, in the case of Burkitt's lymphoma, the disease is caused by a translocation between chromosome 8 and chromosome 14 at a specific break point, which brings the immunoglobulin heavy chain locus close to the c-myc locus. Immunoglobulin on chromosome 14, c-myc, an important oncogene on chromosome 8, and therefore c-myc is now constantly activated by the promoter of the immunoglobulin heavy chain. These are B-cell tumors. Okay, by the way, this translocation was discovered by two Bulgarian scientists, Manolov and Manolova, that worked in the 1970s at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm. They returned to Sofia for the oncology. I met them, very nice partner. And carcinogens can activate some of these oncogenes because they are all exposed to this kind of cancer-inducing agents from food, from air, from drinking, on the environment, you know, sunlight, UV light is an important carcinogen. Cigarette smoke contains a variety of such carcinogens, and therefore cigarette smoking is a clearly dangerous lung cancer. Simply by activating oncogenes that are normally integrated in the chromosome of epithelial cells in the lung. So, let's conclude chapter one. All cells of our body possess potentially cancerous genes, we call them oncogenes. In healthy cells, such genes are activated in a limited and controlled manner to allow tissue formation and regeneration and embryogenesis, the generation of the variety of the immune response cells and genes and so on. However, continuous and uncontrolled activation of such genes by virus, chromosomal translocation, carcinogen, UV, gamma irradiation, etc., may lead to cancer. So I like to compare the cancerous process to wound healing. But these oncogenes are extremely active during the process of wound healing. We get a scratch. Okay, lots of growth factors are released by damaged cells, and they turn on the process of wound healing by delivery of growth stimulatory signals, which are transmitted by oncogenes. However, this is a limited process. Okay, it will stop when the wound is healed and the stimulatory response is resolved. So you can look at wound healing as a self-limiting cancer. It will stop after a while. Okay? And reciprocally, you can say that cancer is unleashed wound healing, which continues forever because there is no signal, counter signal that can stop. So viruses do not induce cancer intentionally. That's not their destiny. Their destiny in life is just like ours, to multiply and generate progeny. Okay, but accidentally, they have acquired an oncogene which is causing cancer. And this accident can happen by other means, not only viruses. Most tumors are not caused by viruses. But viruses are so smart that scientists could use them to decipher the mysteries of the molecular events in question. I'm talking about cancer development, and I'll show you more examples how viruses were extremely instrumental in this regard. So I talked a lot about viruses, I talked a lot about mice, and now let's talk about men and human cancer. And I'm going to do so because I owe you an answer. Why do we not all die of cancer at a young age? So if the seeds of destruction are an integral part of our genome, then one can assume, and I can show you statistical play games that will tell you that some of these oncogenes should be activated and produce cancer before the age of 15. So presumably we all have to develop cancer and drop dead at the age of 15 or before the age of 15. But it doesn't happen. And the answer to this question emerged from looking at a human disease, retinoblastoma. This is a cancer of infants, of babies and young children, cancer of the eye, because it is generated from retinoblasts. The cells that are producing the retina, they are extremely active in childhood, and then they stop dividing when the retina is complete, and therefore you don't see any retinoblastoma in adults, because these cells are non-existent. And really, the name of the game is to keep this child disease-free, sort of, until the age of 5 or 6. The tumor is re-emerging and re-emerging, and earlier years, the only therapy was to remove the eye. Today, the surgery, you know, laser surgery, you can remove the tumor one time after the other until they reach. So there is a race until you reach the age of 5 or 6, and then if the eye is saved, the child will go on with a good vision, and tumor free, of course. Now, there are two forms of retinoblastoma. There is an inherited retinoblastoma, which is bilateral, goes in families, you know, and it will always affect the two eyes. So you get bilateral tumor. And there is another form, a sporadic retinoblastoma, which is not inherited, and always, always involves only one eye. So this is a unilateral, sporadic, and bilateral inherited. And I'd like to introduce you to this gentleman, Alfred Kunson, who was a pathologist. He did not have a leg, he did not have a group, but he had a good brain, a good scientific sense, and he had a board and a chalk. And he began looking at a number of dozens of patients that entered his pathology department for examination, and made all different kinds of statistical plans on the bilateral and the unilateral cohorts. And eventually he came up with this plot. Very hard to understand, but this is the original figure from the paper that we published in 1971. So if you look at the bilateral inherited retinoblastomas, they fall on one line. Okay, it's measuring the age in months at which these patients were diagnosed. All right, if you look at a group of the sporadic cases, those that have a unilateral cancer,
You get this kind of a concave figure.
How to explain? I heard Kunsten talking about his studies about 15 years after the major discovery, and he said there has never been a scientific paper that was cited by so many scientists, but not understood, but even modern. So it's hard to understand. So let me just tell you what is the outcome of these kinds of plot, and you have to believe me that I believe Kunsten, because you are absolutely right. So Kunsten said, look, we have two different situations here. He divided it into a one-hit versus two-hit induction of cancer, or the one-hit versus two-hit theory. In the case of hereditary retinoblastoma, the patients inherit an oncogene, he said oncogene, theoretical oncogene. He did not have a lab to identify it, but he called it RB, retinoblastoma. So this is a mutated gene which potentially cancerous. However, the second gene, the second allele, is wild type. When this allele is mutated again, you know, then the patients are seen tumor. What happens in the sporadic cases, the patient carried when he was born two wild type alleles of the same gene, of the retinoblastoma gene. So it takes two hits in order to develop cancer. First, one allele needs to be mutated, and then the second allele needs to be mutated. And only then you develop cancer. And usually it's unilateral because two mutations, you know, are rare, and you get them either on the right or on the left eye. So people did not accept this theory for many years. I am not going to go through the reasons. It did not fit into the oncogene theory, in which only one mutation was required. Here was speaking about two mutations, that the two alleles needs to be mutated. And it was abandoned, actually rejected by the scientific community, until another major discovery has been done, again, by studying a virus. This time it's a DNA virus, human papilloma virus. Are you familiar with this virus? Of course you are familiar, because you know that human papilloma viruses are causing warts, usually on our finger. Nothing to worry about, these are not cancer, benign tumor. You can remove them by freezing them with liquid nitrogen. Or if you don't like to do this, you wait a couple of months and then they disappear spontaneously. However, there is one strain of HPV. It's HPV number 16, which is extremely dangerous. It causes cancer of the cervix in women. So when it enters the vagina, it adheres to epithelial cells, to the mucus, and then it penetrates these cells. The DNA of the virus integrates with the DNA of the host cell, and after a number of cycles, there is cancer. Now, this is, as I said, a DNA virus, not an RNA virus, more complicated, has many genes. And normally, such viruses do not cause cancer. So what makes the difference between HPV 16 and all other HPVs, which are unharmful? Well, the difference is in two viral oncogenes, E6 and E7. Which are coded in the cancerous virus and do not exist in the non-cancerous viruses. So what is the function of these oncogenes? Why the virus should bother carrying them? Let's look at A6. A gentleman in Princeton University in New Jersey, his name is Arnie Levine, he decided to immunoprecipitate The viral ECG, the product of these genes, form infected cells with specific antibodies. And when he did so, to his great surprise, he found that he co-immunoprecipitated a cellular protein that was unknown at that time. The molecular weight of this protein was 53, thereby his name, P53, protein number 53. It's a cellular protein. So why should HPV-16 carry a gene which codes for a protein that targets and attenuates the cellular protein P53? It took a while to find out that P53 has an important function in the context of the mammalian cell. The product of P53 is causing apoptotic death. You all know what apoptosis is, right? Okay, organ cell death. Now, if P53 is in the cell, then the cell will commit suicide. And that's something the virus hates, because the virus wants to replicate. And he needs a vital cell. So E6 is the protein that makes sure that once the virus infects the cells, these cells will not die, it will never get apoptotic, because it inactivates P53, which is the culprit of apoptosis induction. So P53 is an extremely important protein. It is regarded as the guardian of the genome. Whenever there is a kind of a stress from mammalian cells, P53 will be activated and will remove these cells by apoptosis. Okay, this is what happening also during neoplastic transformation. And that's why it's extremely important for every cancer-causing process to get rid of P53, because if P53 is there, there will not be cancer. The cells will die. And pretty soon, it was appreciated that the RB gene, which was postulated by Kunston and was found on one of the chromosomes, is also a tumor suppressor gene, which acts to inhibit the cell cycle progression of the cell. And sure enough, both P53 and the retinoblastoma genes are part of a larger family of tumor suppressor genes, or tumor suppressor oncoproteins, which their job is to suppress, to inhibit the progression of malignant transformation by various means. So I like to look at the interplay between oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes as if the cell was a car, and in the car we have an accelerator, okay, which you can control with your leg, you know, up and down, and by that make sure that the car is driving in the right speed. But what if this pedal is broken and is now pushed all the way down to the floor? Okay, then the car is accelerating with no control and is going to crash. But this crash can be avoided because you also have another pedal. The other pedal is the tumor suppressor gene, okay, is the brake. If you can still push this pedal, you stop the car, okay, and you don't crash. But if these two pedals are broken at the same time, the accelerator and the brake, nothing can help you. Okay? So this is parallel to the oncogene, this pedal is parallel to the tumor suppressor gene, and we need a mutation in both an oncogene and a tumor suppressor gene to enable the cancerous process to go on. And no wonder that if you look at prevalent cancers, you find that sometimes more than 50% of them, like in the esophagus, ovary, and so forth, breast cancer, more than 50% of the tumors have a mutation in P53.
because it is such an important regulator of the transformation process.
In the 72, all cells of our body possess tumor. Definitely, activation of such genes can offset the transforming activity of an oncogene by arresting sort of retinoblastoma gene or killing represented by TPP3, the affected cell, and inactivation of the tumor, suppressor by mutation or protein degradation, enables an active oncogene to induce cancer. Well, mammalian cell, a biological cell, is much, much more complicated than a car engine, of course. This is a very simplified diagram of what's really happening, because cells normally have more than one tumor suppressor gene or one oncogene. And this appreciation came from studying another human cancer, colorectal carcinoma, cancer of the colon, and that study has been enabled by a rather simple clinical procedure known as colonoscopy, where the physician inserts a tube into the colon, and this tube has a source of light, and even, you know, a little knife there, and it looks, it is surveying the epithelial layer of the colon to find if it has polyps or small tumors. Once the physician will find such an abnormality, he will remove it by surgical incision, and the patient is safe. Because if the tumor is removed at an early stage of the disease, with no metastatic lesions, he is cancer-free. So this is a life-saver procedure, but it enables sampling for research. So in some cases, such physicians do not throw away the sample, but they send them to laboratory. And here you see the grading that was based on this kind of analysis. The malignant process in the colon starts by hyperproliferation that can be seen and removed by the surgeon. Then polyps, okay, then dysplasia. Then you come to the malignant stage, which is adenocarcinoma. If you remove all these forms, the patient is safe. If you wait too much, you get invasive cancer, and at that time, removal of the polyps will not help because you have metastatic disease. So if you look now at those clinical samples in the lab, as has been done by Bert Vogelstein in the University of Maryland in Baltimore, he could identify particular mutations in oncogenes and tumor suppressor genes that are associated with each of the steps. And you see that at the very early stage of a polyp, you get a mutation in an oncogene called APC, some other mutations. As you progress with the process, you get another mutation in an oncogene, KRAS, and you see only in the later stage, you see a mutation in p53, which is a tumor suppressor. So first, the gas accelerator is broken, but still, tumor suppressor proteins are active, so they stop the process, but once they break, once they break, you get a full-fledged disease. And pretty soon it became clear that each of these genes, which is mutated during the process of colorectal carcinoma development, is important for one feature that is essential to be activated during the malignant process. And in the year 2000, they were formulated by Anaheim and Weinberg as hallmarks of cancer, and they act in a cumulative way. So you have a hallmark which is self-growth,
removing a growth inhibitor, limitless replication, tissue invasion, angiogenesis, production of blood vessels, evasion of apoptosis, of course. And when all these hallmarks, okay, are a mess in one cell, it becomes malignant. So here is the picture as we understood the process today. We start with the normal cells, which get one first mutation in an oncogene, but this is not enough to produce cancer. These cells will continue to proliferate as normal cells with one somatic mutation. But one of these cells will acquire a second mutation in another oncogene. Again, still behave as normal cells, but with two mutations. And then a third mutation in a tumor suppressor gene, and a fourth mutation. And we speak about between 10, 12, 13 mutations that need to occur in one cell in order to transform it from normalcy to full malignancy. So we have a stepwise process that's extremely important to remember. And the other very important tenet to remember is that almost all cancer eventually emerged from only one single cell. Okay, that has acquired all these mutations and is now generating a large mass. So this is important for the next part of my talk, but let's summarize the first part. Cancer is a multi-step process characterized by gradual acquisition of specific molecular changes. A malignant tumor arises, well, a malignant tumor arises from one single cell, and cancer development spans over a long period of times, sometimes even years, sometimes even 20 years, until that one single cell will acquire the 10 or 12 necessary mandatory mutations to convert it from normalcy to malignancy. I think it's a good time for a break. So I shall continue for another 15 minutes? Okay, that's fine with me. And you stop me whenever you want. I'm going to take you back to the slide of the hallmarks of cancer. As you see, this is the first diagram that was published in the year 2000. 14 years later, the two gentlemen came with a second paper, and they added additional hallmarks that were discovered during those 14 years. And you see that one of these hallmarks that were added since year 2000 are avoiding immune dysfunction. So what has happened during these 14 years? That immune responses became an important and integral part of the malignant process. Well, that story also begins in 1959, when these two gentlemen, Burnett and Thomas, formulated a theory of immune surveillance against cancer. They claim that we develop transformed cells rather frequently, but these transformed cells are taken care of by the immune response. So during neoplastic transformation, new antigen develops. These cells develop new antigens. The host recognizes them as non-self antigens, as if they were bacteria or viruses. They mount a strong cell-mediated immune reaction against this non-self tumor. And the immune responses act as surveillance system to detect and eliminate newly arising neoplastic cells. So why do we develop cancer? Because something goes wrong in our immune system that cannot check these cells anymore. And since we don't have time, I'm going to skip the experimental evidence for this theory. Why? Because the theory, in its very simplest understanding, was a failure. Because people were trying to use tumor cells as vaccines, okay, to evoke an immune response in cancerous patients that would act against the tumor with no much benefit for the cause of the disease. And here I have a slide that explains why the mouse experiments were misleading, because they are totally different than human cancer, but we don't have time to review it. Let's skip some of the slides and go to the summary. Contrary to experimental tumor, most spontaneous tumors are non-immunogenic, and therefore the theory of immune surveillance is not valid. The immunogenic potential of primary tumors is attenuated during the course of the disease. So viruses or carcinogen-induced tumors were considered the last citadel of the immune surveillance theory, and it was abandoned for quite many years, but got the revival very recently when people started to focus on the cancer microenvironment, not on systemic immunity anymore. Because presumably the important interaction between the immune response, the immune cells and the tumor occur at the vicinity of the tumor, at the site of the tumor. And indeed, people started to isolate lymphocytes from the microenvironment of the tumor. They were termed tumor-infiltrating lymphocytes, which are in close interaction with the tumor cells, and such cells could be activated and propagated in vitro and then reintroduced to the patient, but again, with no much benefit for the patient. And the reason for that was that they were of a very low avidity. They could not interact with the tumor quite well, and they were also exhausted. They could not be well activated once the receptors were occupied by tumor antigens. So here came the advent of chimeric antigen receptors, which were done by genetic engineering with artificial, very potent, strong affinity receptors and artificial cytoplasmic tails containing very strong stimulatory sequences that could deliver the binding of the ligand into the cell, into the nucleus, and activate those cells. And now you can reintroduce the patient's own T cells, which have been manipulated by the CAR technology and express synthetic receptor. And there are limited successes of these approaches, which is explained why it's only limiting. And there are a number of clinical studies now ongoing which shows you the partial benefit of the CAR-T approach. But then came another avenue of investigation, which was based on the newly emerging knowledge that the T-cell receptor is not sufficient, is not enough to induce strong T-cell immunity. Why? Because at the same time, such cells express other receptors like CD28, which is a co-stimulatory receptor. It binds to a molecule on the antigen-presenting cells, here termed B7, and only when both the T-cell receptor and CD28 are engaged, okay, the signal can be delivered to the activating cell. But CD28, which delivers an activatory signal, can be replaced by another protein, for instance, CTLA-4, which delivers an inhibitory signal by binding to the same membrane protein B7. So you have an interplay between two co-stimulatory receptors, one activatory and one inhibitory. And most of the time, in cancer patients, the inhibitory receptors take over. So the idea was to block the activity of the inhibitory receptors we call them immune checkpoint proteins because they put the immune response under check. We're using drugs that are targeting immune checkpoint proteins in order to enable T cells to fight cancer. And there are a number of quite potent drugs that do so. For instance, pembrolizumab, which binds to PD-1, a strong inhibitory checkpoint protein. And there is another drug, these are monoclonal antibodies, humanized monoclonal antibodies that are specific for these proteins. Another drug which blocks CTL4, and we don't have time, but I was going to show you that the combination of the two is the best. So now by using such antibodies, we get really strong inhibitory immune response to cancer, and these are a list of clinical. I just want to show you how elaborate and frustrating is the development of such a modality for the benefit of cancer patients, because it began in 1957 with the formulation of the theory, and then many, many years of hard work with up and downs, and only 2015 we stand at the point when we can use drugs that are targeting immune checkpoint proteins for cancer therapy or immunotherapy. So summary number five, cancer reactive T cells are generally immunosuppressed by the tumor microenvironment and immune and inhibitory receptor manipulation with chimeric antigen receptor can potentiate anti-tumor activity of T cells. Monoclonal antibodies directed at immune checkpoint receptors can augment the killing potential of anti-tumor cells. Okay, if I have time, I can go into chapter 5, which talks about new approaches for cancer treatment, mostly with the direction of precision medicine, but I'm going to talk about precision medicine tomorrow, right? Tomorrow, so it's your decision if you want to hear more, if you can bear with me. I'm here, I can still speak, I'm still sober. You have more? You have another 10 minutes? Okay, just stop me. Just stop me when you feel like.
Just a few minutes for questions. So we will limit the questions from the audience. I think it will be better than to have the opportunity to hear more questions.
Okay. So what do we do now? Go on. You stop me. I need you to stop me because when you stop me, I just want to go to my final slide, okay, which gives you an overall summary. I think it's important. And then we can take questions. Okay. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. You. Let's be a democracy. Okay. Are you voting for the continuation of this talk or against? Okay. Unanimous. You know. No one is responding. Okay. I'm in your hands. You're going to be the chairman of this session, and you tell me when to stop. Okay. I'm back to this slide. And I'm not going to repeat this message, but two important conclusions. One, it's a single cell that begins the disease. So if we are clever to be quick and chase this cell in its infancy, or when there is a small mass generated from this cell for therapy, then we are better now, of course. And the other point is that it's a long process. It takes years. And we have, during those years of latency, we have pre-malignant cells that have acquired some of the mutations, not yet fully malignant, yes, but extremely dangerous. So if we can intervene early on during the process, okay, we can be preventive in a prophylactic manner, right away until the patient is getting cancer, if we can save him this trouble some years earlier than that. Okay? And going on these kind of considerations, so the old generation therapies were comprehensive. Basically chemotherapy and radiotherapy, and now we have new generation of drugs that we call them precision medicine. They are targeted drugs. Okay? They take one aspect of the malignant process, one oncoprotein, one tumor suppressor protein, and they manipulate that particular protein in order to stop the proliferation of the cell. Not only that, but they can be tailored to the patient. You screen the patient genetically, you have a profile, a genomic profile, and then you can pick the desirable drug to treat the individual patient, even though he has the same disease, same colorectal cancer as 10 other patients, but each of them deserves a particular attention with particular drugs that will fit that particular patient. So the first renaissance along this pathway came from a leukemic disease known as chronic myelogenous leukemia. And you heard about the BCR-ABL product that inducing CML. Again, a translocation between two viruses activates an oncogene known as ABL, C-ABL. Why C-ABL? Because there is a V-ABL, a viral ABL. The first ABL was discovered by a virus, a retrovirus that carries ABLism virus. So, again, another lesson from a virus to cancer biology, and shows how this particular mutation is occurring in CML cells. And this is a product of many, many years of research to which my center has also contributed, and the development of Gleevec, which is a synthetic drug that targets the CML enzyme and blocks the activity of this enzyme and therefore stops the progression of the disease. And you see the fantastic benefit of using Gleevec and CML cells. I see these are data from the early 2000s, and now it's even better in terms of survival. And it takes a long time, you see. The first discovery of the translocation was in 1960, and only 40 years later, you have a drug. No shortcuts, no shortcuts. You have to, if you hear about a guy who is trying to sell you an anti-cancer drug, which we have developed in a year or two, don't believe it. He's a sharp man. Anyhow, so Gleevec is a prototype targeted drug for CML, but it's not a personalized drug, because you give Gleevec to all patients developing CML. All of them has this translocation. But if you look at human breast carcinoma, for instance, you see that you can divide them into subgroups. For instance, you have HER-positive and HER-negative patients. You heard about HER, okay, HER2, which is a tyrosine kinase, okay? Again, it's a molecule, an oncoprotein, which can be highly expressed. About 20% of the patients will express HER, and therefore can be benefited from anti-HER therapy. But you need to detect them. This becomes personalized. You will give anti-HER therapy, again, a monoclonal antibody against that protein HER, to 20% of the patients. The other 80% will not receive it because they don't express HER. They can get another drug or conventional chemotherapy. And here you see the benefit for the patients by using that particular drug. This is the scheme that shows you the function of HER, now a monoclonal antibody, which is now a drug, can remove HER2 from the membrane of the cells and then block the growth signal. So Herceptin is really a prototype targeted and personalized drug, and there are many, many more examples like this for other tumors, which I'm going to skip, and I'll go to the summary, selection of specific drugs targeted and patients personalized makes the basis for precision medicine in cancer management, and precision cancer medicine is in its infancy and holds a great promise for future therapy. I'll take the very last 3 or 4 minutes to speak about prophylactic treatments for cancer, because I believe, I teach medical students, and I keep telling them, the true job of a good physician is not to treat diseases, it's to avoid them, to prevent them. And we can prevent cancer, certain cancer, by prophylactic treatment. Number one, vaccination. And number two, preventive drugs that will be given to high-risk individuals. So as for prophylactic vaccination, the prototype example is the HPV-16 vaccine that I told you about causing cancer of the cervix. I believe this vaccine is given today to girls in this country, like in Israel, young girls, because it protects them from getting the disease. I think it should be given to boys as well, because they are transmitting the virus, even though they don't get the disease. And people hear from me, listen to me. I think that in another year or two, it will be given to boys as well in Israel. But however, what this vaccine is doing is a viral protein using antivirus proteins, and with these antibodies pre-exist in the girl, once she's exposed to HPV-16, these antibodies will coat the virus and will prevent the initial primary infection, and therefore it is highly protective for getting cervical cancer. But vaccines can be applied to a small proportion of cancer when there is a viral involvement and so on and so forth. So therefore, another approach would be to use preventive drugs, which you apply to perfectly normal individuals. They do not have cancer. But you give them a drug because you assume that some of them will develop cancer in another 5 or 10 years. Finasteride is one such drug because it's an effective inhibitor of testosterone, which is responsible for the development of prostate carcinoma. And this is a study where finasteride is given to healthy males, you know, from the age of 50 or 55, that's it, 55, and you can tell right away that one pill a day of this drug has a protective effect against developing prostate adenocarcinoma. Perhaps the best preventive drug is aspirin. Aspirin is an anti-inflammatory drug. And many, many cancers are driven by chronic inflammation. So if you reduce the level of inflammation by a daily pill of aspirin, it protects you from getting cancer. And I recommend to males and females from the age of 40, something like that, to take daily aspirin. It's a very low risk. Physicians are still not doing it. They don't recommend it because there are some potential harms that are involved, you know, bleedings and stuff like that. But considering the benefits of cancer prevention, I think it should be given for free, of course. So here I come to the general conclusion. Today, 1 out of 3 individuals will develop cancer, but it can be reduced to 1 out of 6 if we are good enough to treat such individuals. If we use targeted and personalized drugs, which is the future of cancer therapy, it can be made 1 out of 9. And if we are good enough to prevent cancer by vaccines and preventive drugs, maybe 1 out of 12 back 100 years when cancer was the 8th cause of death after car accidents. Thank you. It was a pleasure being with you. That's the opening. That's the campus of the Hebrew University. All city. But you have to come. pronounce it. And I can take a question.
Thank you for this brilliant academic lecture focused on the molecular and immunological aspects of cancer. Actually, it was a wonderful overview and something like an academic fairy tale, starting from the role of oncogenes that you know already from the course of biology, then going to the point of view of immunologists and the role of the immune system and the various theories and hypotheses. Focused on immunology and the role of the immune system on cancer development, and then at last we heard about the possibilities to prevent and treat the cancer. And maybe you know that most of these approaches are also applicable in our country, and we use most of those targeted drugs and this targeted therapy for the treatment of the cancer patients, such as Tarceva and Herceptin and Nivolumab and many others. So we have just 1 or 2 minutes for burning questions. Do you have any questions? I think you may have many questions, but just some of you. Yes, please.
Microphone.
Professor, you mentioned something about the reason why cancer is on the rise. Something goes wrong with our immune system. So why do you think that there's more and more kind of problems with the immune system? Why cancer is on the rise? Is it stress? Is it working too hard? What could be the...
So if I answer that your question, to what extent the theory of immune surveillance is really holding against most cancers or one part of cancer, so on and so forth. So first of all, okay, the immune response is not the only immunity that we have against cancer. Okay? This is probably, okay, the very last effective compartment that protects us against cancer. So we have genetic and epigenetic and intercellular and intracellular and so on interaction. So we have to look at the immune response as one part in a large host of immunity. So I speak about immunity, not immunology is part of immunity. You understand what I mean? Immunity is much larger scope than just immunology. So if all the other protective mechanisms have failed, okay, and wiped out all the other hallmarks of cancer, then we are left with the immune response. So this is the last resort of protection. And sometimes it works, certainly when we have virally induced tumor, because the virus is recognized as foreign, and the immune response will act against the virus, which is in cancer cells. Of the cancer cell is eradicated. But many other cancers do not express non-self antigens. If they express non-self antigens, tumor antigens, they are of low avidity, low affinity. Or, in a worst case, they are modulated. Okay, so the tumor begins with tumor antigen. You think about a scheme where a patient is treated by chemotherapy, radiotherapy, and then he is disease-free, but he's in remission. Okay, he has a minimal residual disease with few cells, and these cells are under immune check, but they start to modulate. Okay, and eventually you get a clone or several new clones, which are low immunogenic, low antigenic, and they will emerge and relapse. Okay, there are certain cases where the immune response is extremely potent in removing those cancer cells, and therefore we do not see them, we do not consider this patient sick. He has never gotten cancer, even though he had transformed cells in our body, and I guess most of us had transformed cells or are going to have fully transformed cells in our body, but we will not never recognize them because our immune system is doing a good job.
Just one more question,
yes,
please.
you because I like to have a conversation rather than general discussion.
First of all, thank you for being here.
Thank you.
Yes, we are happy to welcome you and know you. I wanted to ask you, how do you connect chancrogenesis with embryogenesis? How do you connect chancrogenesis with embryogenesis?
How do you associate cancerogenesis with embryogenesis?
Cancerogenesis, okay, cancer development and embryogenesis.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, you all hear me, right? Because I'm still connected. So all of these oncogenes that I was talking about are extremely active, okay? During pregnancy, during embryogenesis. Because if you look at embryogenesis from the standpoint of continuous proliferations of cells and building of tissues and organs, this is more like cancer, like wound healing of cancer, right? But this process is totally controlled and coordinated. So these oncogenes are activated, all of these oncogenes that I've shown are activated, and they allow controlled proliferation, division, and expansion of cells, building of new tissues, new organs. Apoptosis, by the way, as well, P53 is highly active during embryogenesis because part of our tissues needs to be removed, okay? Like you know that our digits are connected during pregnancy, okay? But then it's separated by apoptosis. So all of these events are occurring at embryogenesis, but this is a fully coordinated, I would say, cancer in concept, okay, which will obey the law of the conductor. When you look at cancer, which appears later on, the same oncogenes are now acting in an uncontrolled fashion. They do not respond to inhibitory signals from the environment. Okay? They are fully activated. Continuously, constantly activated, either by a virus, or by a translocation, or by a transgene, or by a spontaneous mutation. So we get somatic mutations that will affect those oncogenes that we do not see during embryogenesis. But the same rules of activity of those oncogenes applies for both embryogenesis and cancer. Is this answering the question?
I'm afraid we do not have time to cover the question just for the last one, and then we will continue outside.
One big question about the aspirin.
1700
milligrams. 70 to 100 milligrams.
Yes,
for the cardio preventing.
70 for a day.
Okay. Milligrams per
tablets. I'm afraid that we don't have 70 milligrams tablets in our country.
No?
I think it's 100.
100. Yeah.
Okay. So thank you again. Thank you for Professor Evanov, and thank you for the audience being here. We can continue outside. If you have any questions, please go outside because we have another lecture
here
at Professor Sabinan. We'll continue her lecture with the other audience. Thank you again.
Yeah.
Да.